Dear viewers, welcome to this new episode of our program, Dialogue Corridor. Last week, the president delivered his speech before the parliament, in which he talked about different issues about immigration, about the policies, and about also the economy, the hardship of the economy. And he also promised all the people in Sudan with a good living situation. Inside the studio with me is Mr. Kamal Ismail. He's a former state minister in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. Yes, welcome with you.
Thank you very much.
And also we have Nahar Osman Nahar. He's the state minister in the Ministry of Agriculture. Welcome with you.
Thank you for having me here.
Okay, so let me begin with the eldest one. You are the eldest one, I think.
I guess okay. So.
It's about the speech of the president in the session of the parliament, before the parliament, and he's talking to the Sudanese people about different things and stage. Tell me about the speech first and the coming stage.
Bismillah, alhamdulillah, salam, salam, salam. Usually when a president delivers a speech in the parliament, he almost describe and prescribe his policy for the future, as well as diagnoses the problems and the issues for the present, and what is his policies and his strategies in order to tackle these issues. So this is why this speech has covered several aspects, among which was the economic situation in Sudan, the constitution situation, as well as the foreign policy, and what he have taking place in different angles in the Sudan, South Sudan relations. Efforts has been done in this regard, achieving peace. Our bilateral relations with neighboring countries, with the regional organization and the region as general. So the speech was very general and was also very specific in pinpointing the problems and what suggestions and solutions that he proposed for the future.
Okay, okay. So let me pass the same question to you, Mr. Nahar. It is about maybe about the economy, for example, because all the people now looking forward to the economy. But give me some touches about the speech of the president.
You know, yes, the address by the president of the republic in the new session of the legislative body with his the two chambers. It is always putting the agenda for the next session or the next year. So by doing that, the president puts the main areas of concerns for the Sudanese now, beginning with the economical crisis, after that about also the political situation, the national dialogue, the role of the legislative body also in monitoring and so on, evaluating the executive branch, because the three branches of the government, the legislative, the executive, and the judiciary. And also I spoke about the relationship with the outside world, and the emphasis of his speech is about the economical, political, the situation right now, and also the ambitions and the dreams for the future.
Yeah, of course. So within the speech, I think that many kind of points and indicators that the policies in the coming, for example, about the budget, for example, of 2019, which is very important for the people, and also some kind of now amendment of the constitution, many important things that link to the Sudanese citizen in favor of them. How do you look to this?
As also my colleague over here mentioned, the address has covered several areas, but usually people are very much concerned about the economic issues, and then next to that come maybe constitutional amendment or foreign policy and so on and so forth. And as a matter of fact, even the speech itself also has make more emphasis in the economic situation. The speech of the president was very candid and transparent. He diagnoses and describes and prescribes the problems in a very clear manner. and he recognized that there's a problem that we have as the Sudanese people are exercising a very harsh and tough economic situation. And what he perceived or how he see in order to get rid of this difficulties and problems, and he have put some plans and ideas in order to move forward. Yeah. Over and above, he spoke also about the civil servant and our need and the need of the economy in order to have a very slim, active, and effective civil servant in order to execute the programs of the for the future.
Yes.
So this is very important, and as a matter of fact, most people agree that our civil servants is so, to some extent, is so fat, and it needs a lot of weight losing process. It has to be slim, it has to be active, it has to be productive, and this has to be reformed. It has to be retrained and redirected in order to execute these plans which has been delivered by the president. Other aspects also were spoken about, but most people have interest in to see how the president's going to address the issue of economy.
Yeah.
And I think he has pinpointed some points and some issues and in order to tackle during the next budget.
Yeah.
The budget of 2019 should be also very clear, should be very transparent, should address the economic issues in a very clear way.
Yeah.
And we should no longer, or the budget should no longer make any emphasis in consumer subsidies. All subsidies should be directed to producers. And this was being clearly in the decision of the Prime Minister Mahathir, that he declared the price of the wheat for the next year 1,800 Sudanese pounds. And I think this was very valid and sound decision taken by His Excellency. And I think, and it shows that he will support and subsidize the producers and not the consumers. Has he continued this type of policy with vigor and force? I think we are moving forward and the agricultural sector will really achieve some positive result.
Okay, he's mentioned that agricultural sector, this belongs to you as the minister. You are the most recent minister in the cabinet. Now, I think that when we talk about production, food, and agriculture in Sudan, we have to talk about the policies, the future policies for the Minister of Agriculture. We forget about the recent policies of whoever in the post of the minister, but for now, people thinking about production, productivity, exactly in Sudan, because Sudan still has a potential of agriculture.
Yes.
What do you think about this?
Actually, yes, for Sudan, a country like Sudan with its potential, I think the agricultural sector must be the lead in the economic activities in the country. And I think also the beginning of this government, the new cabinet of Mates Musa, I think also the emphasis in the agricultural sector was clear by the first meeting of the Council of the Minister was in Wad Madani and the Jazeera project, and that also is a clear message to the inside people in Sudan and outside world that the agricultural sector will take its lead in Sudan. And by doing so also, we have to look at it from different angles, because there is also some other steps that must be taken to lead to the growth in the agricultural culture. One of these steps is that the reform of the civil service also, because also the civil service now in Sudan need reform. It is very big and also it is inefficient, and also some of the laws of the using of the land and the agricultural sector laws also need amendment to make it most easy for the agricultural people and for the investors also from outside Sudan to come and to take part in this transformation. I think one of the things also that we need also to catch up with the world in transforming our way to doing agriculture that's be in the irrigated sector or in the rain sector. Because now with the e-agriculture, the smart agriculture, we need to use some techniques with also the transformation in the ecological system and the drought that sometimes also hit some countries. Now even in Europe there is drought in some countries. So the smart agriculture that to use the technology to monitor the effect of the ecological condition in the agriculture and like the sometimes the drought and also and the other bits besides that can also compromise the production. So for Sudan to go in this way, we need also to emphasize in the productivity and to enhance the productivity of the agriculture people.
Okay, so Mr. Kamal Ismail, let us remain in this issue of the agriculture. And as your colleague just mentioned that the laws about agriculture, the taxes, for example, another amendment that help the small scale farmers to go forward, to train them, to give them some tips and advices how to make this production to go forward. What do you think about this? Is there any policies, new policies for that, in order to make the productivity to go forward in production and to also to utilize the effort of youth here in Sudan, as you know that 70% of the people are youth here in Sudan?
Yes, as the minister said, we need more effort in order to reform our agricultural sectors in order to raise and increase the productivity in this sector. As a matter of fact, we are far behind in technology used for producing agricultural products. As a matter of fact, as the former Minister of Finance, Arikabi, said, we are doing agriculture with the stone age of technology, which has been the for technology of our grandfathers.
Yeah.
It's no longer valid. It could no longer help to speed up the process in production.
Yeah.
So we need to do this. We need to inject new ideas, new technology, new technical know-how in order to improve the agriculture. And that is, as a matter of fact, this was recommended by several conferences before. For several economic conferences, meetings, workshops had been held in this regard, and they have recommended introducing new techniques and technology in order to improve the productivity in the agriculture sector. That's correct, and that is needed. But the whole difference is that before, I guess, people were so lenient in applying these policies. I guess now the Prime Minister Martes have the gut and the capability and capacity and the knowledge in order to apply all these recommendations and all these technical know-how and introduction technology in the agricultural sector. The problem is not just to prescribe or describe the policies. The problem is how your ability to apply them, to implement them. It needs follow-up, it needs vision, it needs also vigor and political force behind that.
Yeah.
And I have with high degree of confidence, yeah, believe that the Martes have all these qualities, yeah, in order to follow up all type of reforms in the agricultural sector and in all sectors, as a matter of fact.
Okay.
And just to mention his last decision in increasing the price of wheat, uh-huh, and I think that was the right decision at the right time. And I'm pretty confident this will make a difference in for our production of wheat for the next year. So the problem is not the policies only. Policy is important, plans is essential, but above all, political will. and ability and the vigor in order to implement those policies is the issue, and I guess the guy will do that.
Okay, so if I come to you, it is about the same thing. It's about the policies that should be implemented by who would follow up, and that is a lack in the previous days. No follow up, for example, no monitoring, no good vision, no any plans putting, and no any plans implemented. The real critical problems in Sudan is how to implement your plan. It's only on the papers.
Yes, thank you very much. As I begin with what my colleague Kamal Ismail said, that what we need here, and we have it here, is a political will. I think this government came after a consultation and after a decision from the President of the Republic to go through this reform way. And I think also the team that was gathered, I think it is capable to do that. That was from one side. The thing that in Sudan we hit with the Dutch disease, and still now we have some side effects of that. The Dutch disease, as the economists know, when you have an increase in one sector, you have a decline in other sectors. In our case, when we had the petrol and the money of the petrol in the 20s, from the beginning of this century, the increase in that money from the petroleum sector make us neglect some of the other vital sectors, like the agricultural sector and pastoral sector and the other sectors in the Sudanese economy. So now it is high time to continue, because before even the petrol comes to Sudan, that our lead economist since the independence, that we are an agricultural country. That from one side. Also, we lag behind in term of the percentage of the GDP, the gross domestic product, and also the from the budget of the government that was given to the agricultural sector. The normal for the development goals, it is between 10 to 15% from the budget of the state. But now in Sudan, we lack behind in that. In order to improve and to reform the agricultural sector, the government needs more resources to be directed towards the agricultural sector. Mm-hmm. That from other side. Also, we don't forget, we have the potential here, and we have also things that Sudan, it is now the area that we cultivate, it is around 53, this year was 53 million hectare. And the projected areas was 45, and now we offer do our estimation even by around 15%, and that also mean the harvest season will be good, and will be also we need some work to do in produce and to get these products like fertilizers and pesticides and even the money for the season of the harvest season. Mm. All that things we need, and also we need to reform the sector by adding the value change for the products that we produce here in Sudan, like the peanuts and the sesame and the sunflower and the wheat. Mm. Wheat, it is for the internal consumption, but the other things for the export, and we can produce them here and to take the advantage of the value chain of it, and also increase the value that we get when we export it. Other things also, I think it is very important to reform the agricultural sector, the partnership between the private sector and the public sector. Mm-hmm. And that's also need to do some work also in the public finance sector. And I think also if we want to get the investors, inside investor or the outside investors, we have to do reforms in the laws and the mechanism in the civil service also of this sector. Mm-hmm. to make it more attractive for the people, because the businessmen like to get their money and mm-hmm. in a transparent way, and finally they think about the return of their money. So yeah, to make the environment more conducive for doing business in Sudan, I think we need to go through these reforms that has been mentioned. And also I applaud the effort of the Prime Minister Musa by his beginning, because as we see, he's a follow-up man, and also he's a a field man, and that a testimony for that is his also trips to different area from the in the country. And we need what we need, especially in the civil service, that the follow up. Yeah. We lag behind a lot in the follow up, and I think with the spirit that now began with this government, I think we can go far away.
Okay, so you mentioned that we have to change the system of the irrigation, for example, as you know that United States now using sprinklers and using dropping irrigation, some other systems. But I'm not talking about that system of irrigation. That's right. I'm talking about the utilization of our natural resources here without any agriculture. It is natural. For example, gum arabic is natural. How we can use this, how you can utilize this, and how we can make, as he mentioned, that good processing for the gum arabic, and also the policies inside, export, import.
Gum arabic, one of the very vital products that Sudan have advantage of. According to some estimations, we probably produce more than 70%, up to 80% of the whole world production of gum arabic. This gives us the merit to have a real say on how to produce, how to sell, to even to determine the price. Nonetheless, this is not the case, because trade of trade and export of gum for several years, as a matter of fact, since it started to be exported, was done in a very traditional way with a very specific number of people and companies. It's almost monopoly system. Some estimates show that the total value of the trade of gum arabic worldwide is about $8 billion a year. While we in Sudan, who produce more than 70%, we get only $80 million. Maybe less than 1%. So it needs a new policy. It needs a very different and crazy ideas in order to utilize these natural resources effectively and efficiently and profitably. Yeah. So, but if we continue to do business as usual, we will end up nowhere. Yeah. We have to feel and to introduce policies that is quite different, it's quite abnormal, with new vision, with new ideas, and that will be the case of gum arabic, of sesame, of peanuts, and whatever type of products we produce. We do not need to continue produce in this way and export in the same way. Yeah. New ideas should be introduced, new visions. New partnership, as my colleague here said, we can get in a very effective partnership with the private sector, whether national or internationally. So that will give us the advantage.
Okay. Okay. So if I come to you, we can go back to the speech of the president before the parliament. It's about the executive system, as you know that, which is needed now. And also we talk about the reform. Uh-huh. In the civil services. Uh-huh. It's 2 points which I think that very important.
Yes, what I find interesting in the speech by the president that he mentioned a lot of things that needs to be clarified also and to be discussed and studied by the two chambers of the parliament. Uh-huh. One of the things also he emphasis in the peace process that the hand that we are still tending for the people outside the peace process, and also the repeated ceasefire declaration, unilateral ceasefire declaration from the side of the government, and also the political will to also go through the dialogue, national dialogue outputs, yeah. And to realize them. And the first thing that I think the president does, his acknowledgement the crisis, yeah. The economical crisis. That's the beginning when you clearly that declare there is a problem. After that, you go through how to find a solution for that. Yeah. And I think there is a measures must be taken to to get out of this economic crisis. And also he mentioned that he, with a collaboration and in consultation with other components of the National Concord government. And that is very interesting point also, mm-hmm. because the people think that maybe this only the policies of the NCP, the National Congress Party, as the dominant party. But I think all these measures is, was in a national concord and a national consensus, and that is very important thing. Also the spirit of this government, and that the hope, the confidence that the citizen also welcome this government, it is very remarkable. I think in the recent years we didn't get a government that if we have pulse and we can track that this government has a very high estimation from the citizens, and we have also to get that stock of confidence and build open it and to go. Mm-hmm. And the civil service also reform, that one of the when the issues that also put us behind and didn't give us the opportunity to go forward. Mm-hmm. And other thing also, as you know, the president also mentioned that the causes of this economical crisis, some of the causes were internal causes and some of the causes was external. The internal causes that we lost the money from the export of petroleum after the separation of South Sudan, mm. and also and the problems, the war in Sudan also, Darfur and in the two areas, that was the problem. Also the embargo that we have from some countries, yeah. Either that was declared or it is hidden, but we yeah. have also. And also he emphasized in that with Sudan, we have now good relationship with China, yeah. with Turkey, and with India, Russia, yeah. and Korea. And I think we have to monetize on that also and to build. And also there is openings even with the United States of America. And I think that also we have to go forward in this way.
Okay. So. Back to you, Mr. Kamal. I think that what he mentioned is very important, but also the president mentioned that fighting against corruption and trying to build up a new mission or commission of fighting corruption, which we said that civil services, inside the civil services, there is corruption. When we find civil services is weak and some kind of corruption elements inside. So how the coming verse of fighting on corruption in Sudan?
I think also one of the good policies, one of the good issues that have been raised nowadays is corruption fighting campaign. And this is very essential and very important, because corruption is considered as a cancer in any economy. Unless we get rid of it, or at least minimize it, no economy will go nowhere. Because it is just leakage. It is whatsoever you do about the national economy in the whole tank or pot, there is a huge leakage coming downwards. So that is corruption. Corruption leaks the natural resources indirectly or directly, and then will make the economy very weak. Unless you have a very specific and very strong position against the corruptions, you can go nowhere. Because whatever production, whatever productivity you raise, mm-hmm. it end up in the pockets of some very few people. And that is so-called corruptions. And I think it's good that the government has embarked or involved in a corruption anti-corruption campaign. They have got a lot of corrupt people under investigations. Some of them confess that they have committed some corruptions. Investigation is going on. But the good news, this campaign, this policy, declared policy, this practice against corruption had at least downgrade or decrease, if not eliminate, corruption altogether. So corrupt people in the back are just waiting and seeing what the government is going to do with these corrupt people under her arrest. If the government takes a very strong measures against these corrupt elements, then the followers will keep quiet, will avoid corruptions, will cease corruption. Okay, but if the government policy was so lenient towards these corrupt elements, then this will encourage and entice the others who are waiting and in the back to come and practice more corruption. But corruption is very serious disease, and it really hampers the economies completely. This applies to any economy, whether in Sudan, Nigeria, Dutch economy, Swiss economy, Kenyan economy. Wherever there is high rate and degree of corruption, then the economy can go nowhere. Yeah. It cannot help to improve at all. So the good things that I, as a matter of fact, I recommend or I commend this policy of anti-corruption campaign, and I hope this will be a continuous process, because corruption is not a pinpoint action. It is a continuous process. So it needs a continuous actions also and campaign in order to combat corruptions. And this will help. As a matter of fact, nowadays, even these measures have been taken against this small limited corrupt people has make a real effect and influence. And this also make a high degree of satisfaction, political satisfaction for the people. Because now the people under the impression that the government fight corruption, the government have a campaign against corruption, against the corrupt people, and I think this will give a very good political lift up for the political system. This apply, and I hope the government will continue this tough policy towards corruption.
Okay, so Mr. Nahar, let us go in the same, but I want to add something to you. It's about the smuggling the Sudanese products, as you know that. With borders, Sudan, some kind of smugglers working, also to undermine the economy by taking natural, for example, products or even our products here in the bordering areas.
Yes. You know, also the smuggling is part of the corruption. I mean, one also of the side six of the corruption. And drain the natural resources by exporting some of the items that were subsidized for the use of the citizens of Sudan, like the gas oil, the petrol, and the other petroleum products, and the wheat and sugar, and all that were subsidized. And one of the problems that in Sudan, the subsidies are not well distributed, because the poor and the rich get the same subsidies, and also we have also to look on this side of the thing of the subsidies and to make it more to the needed people, and also to alleviate poverty by directing this money also to the production sectors, for the agriculture sector, for the industrial sector and the other pastoral sector, and trying to stop or to minimize the direct subsidies that goes to items that going to all people. That's one of the things. As for the smuggling, I think one of the things that is an example also of the Arabic gum. The Arabic gum is produced here in Sudan, and Sudan was one or the leader producer of the Arabic gum, but it is not even mentioned in the exporting country of the Arabic gum, because our products goes to neighboring countries, and after that goes to the international market. And I think it is very easy to tackle this problem, a specific problem, by opening like a stock market for the and our national product, our agricultural product. In that way, as a small producer, a small farmer can directly know, and now the communication revolution can know the price in London or New York in the same time that when he is in his farm or in his village. By that, we eliminate the brokers in between that get profit of this, and we can stop that thing. Also by changing the policies around the subsidies, we can stop the smuggling for our items, national items, to our side. That from one side. From other side also, I think by giving some stimulus for the economy and for the production also, we can also boost the economic boom as now going. And I also definitely agree with my colleague Kamal Ismail in that the corruption kills everything you do. Whatever you do without stopping, we have to have a zero tolerance policy against anti-corruption. And I think the measures that the President of the Republic took from the beginning of this year as a hope, and the people that knows the personality of the new Prime Minister, Kamal, I think one of the people who know him very well, I think he will go in this pass forward, and I think the fighting and the anti-corruption will go forward also, that all for the benefit of the people of Sudan.
Yeah.
Other thing also, Sudan also, President mentioned one particular phrase for me. I think that when he talk about diplomatic, economical diplomacy,
yeah,
and Minister Kamal was one of the leaders in the foreign affairs department of our government. Yeah. Also, I want him also to elaborate more in this side.
Yeah. And a volunteer. That's right. Okay. So let me ask you about the role of Sudan, as mentioned, that in building peace in Africa, the role of Sudan in the international issues like immigration and fighting human trafficking and others, also mentioned by the president, but still no any any response from the international community towards Sudan for help. Sudan needs help from the international community, not for the effort he done, but for the things that, for the peace in Africa, for example, for the peace all over the world, global peace.
Yes. May I just
add something?
One point of what my friend over here.
Yeah, you can go ahead.
Said about subsidy.
Yes.
He said subsidize all people together and also is unfair. That's not good. We have to have a specific
measures
in order to direct the subsidy to those who need it.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, he's correct. But the problem in our subsidy system in Sudan, we do not subsidize all people. We subsidize the rich people.
Yes.
Yeah.
We subsidize the consumers.
How?
Yes.
Because we subsidize flour and wheat, which is being eaten by the people in the urban areas and the rich people.
Even electricity.
Yeah.
Electricity.
Yeah.
The whole nomadic society in Sudan do not use electricity.
Yeah.
While the government subsidizes electricity. So that means it taxes the nomads and the farmers in order to subsidize the city settlers or these urban areas or whatever. So as a matter of fact, the measure extremely against whatever type of equality and equity and so on and so forth.
Yes.
But it happened in the past due to political pressure. Have the government been clear enough? Have the courage and the gut to apply a fair and just policies, it has to abolish subsidy policies altogether. Otherwise, we will continue taking money from the poor and give it to the rich.
Yeah.
For example, in Kenya and whatever in Uganda, there is no subsidy for the government for the electricity. What's the problem?
Yeah.
There is no subsidy for the bread. Okay, this trade is going straight forward. The government do not divert any amount of its budget to subsidize specific products and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
This has been for historical reasons. As a matter of fact, due to the economic school of Khartoum University in the early 70s.
Yeah.
So we have to think serious about this.
Yeah.
Referring to your point,
which
was,
it is you
foreign
it.
Policy.
It is the foreign policy, a role of Sudan, an effort of Sudan in building peace in Africa, and also the contribution of Sudan in immigration.
Sudan, yes, the president has mentioned the economic diplomacy that more emphasis in economy that encourages foreign policies of foreign investors in order to come and invest in Sudan, and also would work to transfer technology and technical know-how in different areas in Sudan. And I think the Minister of Foreign Affairs has been doing this for quite some time, and now it would be even more enthusiastic to continue the same policy in order to encourage foreign investment to come to Sudan, in order to avail information about the potentiality in Sudan and how this will be very attractive for investors in order to come and invest in Sudan, despite the all negative campaign Sudan has facing in the foreign countries. But regarding also the effort of Sudanese diplomacy in the area and in the region, no one could deny that. And as a matter of fact, Sudan has played a very essential role in achieving peace in South Sudan, has now is playing the same role with Central Africa. Also, it helped to facilitate solve problems with different neighboring countries. And it has a very important role in the AU policies and strategies. So, and also even in the international arena, all issues about peace, equality, development, growth, fairness, in United Nations issues, Sudan was always contributing very positively. And all this regarding your question, why does the international community does not recognize the effort being done by Sudan? Simply because international policy and diplomacy depends on interests and not fairness. So some people or some countries have specific interests, so they would not appreciate whatsoever you do, regardless of whether that's good or not. We have to live with this this fact. We have to exert maximum policy in the international arena, in the foreign policy, but we should not expect reward from any other community unless that community will be having specific interests in Sudan, economic interests or otherwise, and then by that point they will recognize our effort.
Okay, so I come back to you also, Mr. Nahar. It is about the partnership. For example, in different centers to boost the economy. You know that economy need, particularly in your Ministry of Agriculture, which is very important now. It's different countries in Africa, in Europe, in Asia, Arab world can invest in agriculture in Sudan in a good way.
Yes. Before that, I go back to the subsidy problem. I was last week. I was in Kenya, and when I asked about the fuel prices there, it is were. Approximately $1.10, and in Sudan it is 10 cents only. One liter of fuel, and you see that we subsidize every liter with $1, and that is a huge money for Sudan, and that's one side of the problem. Even in Chad, the neighboring Chad also, it is more than $1. And for the wheat, we subsidize the wheat 50 million Sudanese pound per day, and so on. And as Mr. Kamal mentioned, that these subsidies goes to the people who live in cities and the people who well off. But for the majority of the Sudanese people who are in the countryside, they didn't even use electricity, they don't even use fuel, or even gas for kitchen. And that is outside of the whole process. So the dilemma here is how to reach these people and make them more productive by aiding them through the state to eliminate also the poverty between them and to make them a productive people. This is a very big challenge for this government to go through. Coming back to your question, I think the first thing that to make people from outside, investors or partnership with other countries outside Sudan to come, to make the environment conducive for doing business. And I think this also goes through also to how to make the laws for the investment, for the land owning or land borrowing, and also how to make auto easy to the flow of the money from inside to outside. And also I think the last political or economical decision and measures that's taken by the government in the way of opening for the economy and the rate of the exchange rate for the Sudanese currency against the dollar or other, that can stimulate firstly the outflow or the money come from our expats in our side, and also to make the environment conducive. I think also we have a partnership with different organizations, FAO and other UN agencies for this thing. But we can learn from other countries like us in Africa or China and other people of the BRICS people, and to cooperate, because we have the land, we have the water, we have the resources, we have the potential to lead that. But all that it go in a combination, I think, with what we do in our government and the laws and measures that we take.
Thank you very much, because our time now
is ended. Yes, your time
ends. Yeah, I have a minute.
But okay. If you have 1 minute, may I get a crazy idea?
Yeah.
What will happen if the government or the Minister of Agriculture distribute fertilizers free for the farmers?
It is a good policy. Yes. Are you agree with that?
Yes. In place of subsidizing the wheat or the electricity.
Yes. Okay.
Yes. Okay. That's the way of subsidizing.
I would like to thank you, Mr. Kamal Ismail. Also, I'd like to thank you,
Nahar
Osman Nahar, for being with us in our program, Dialogue Horizon. Dear viewers, that's all we have in this episode of our program, Dialogue Horizon. Until we meet again. Goodbye.